Grew up in a little town in western New York State, really fortunate to grow up on a lake. So big influences for me were wind, water, weather, swimming underwater with my eyes open in what I call the deep green. Went to college, studied English, important because I wanted to be a poet. Music, important because I became a musician. I graduated from Smith and was part of the folk music scene in the early 60s. Went to the Village, played that one through, went into theater, television, did a lot of television, a lot of work on children's programs and other things as well, some films. Did all the things you do when you're a young person in New York, studied dance and jazz and improv and musical theater and all that. And did some off-Broadway. And then, left. I bought an old farm up in the hills of western Massachusetts, where I still live.
Down on the farm we get up in the morning early.
Where I still am, here. And became part of that movement in the 60s of back to the land and intentional community, communes, and dove into a whole world that was very different for me. I was singing mostly Irish Celtic ballads and, you know, pretty music as a lyric soprano. And I went to the land and began to really root myself and grow myself in a different way. So I began to write my own music. I started my own group called Sumitra with cello and flute and voice, piano, started playing the piano again. Married again, unmarried again, had some pretty rough times, and my kids went away to school, and I went back to school myself and got my doctorate in consulting psychology, got my master's and then my doctorate, and became a working psychologist. Worked in the mental health, community mental health scene, working with trauma, did my doctoral work on trauma and using the voice to create a practice I called creative resonance, and began to train and do workshops in Western Europe, all over the place. I began to move out and teach and train. I worked in Antioch and some other colleges, teaching counseling and working with this trauma and the voice work. Pursuing a very different lifestyle. I write a lot. I get back to my root system in poetry. I published a book this year called Up to the Windy Gate, Poems of Grief and Grace, about the death of my longtime music partner, Sarah Benson. And I actually won a prize, the Robert Frost Poetry Prize.
Two girls, woodpile. Tall farmer daughters, sturdy in tight jeans and denim jackets that they'll shed as bending, picking up and stacking, bending down again, they build the pile. I'm with them, keeping up, but pausing to take breaks, pacing myself for the 60 years between us. The girls forge on, bend, lift, stack, turn, and bend again. They put their gram's wood in the day before. Their grandma, my age probably, did not join stacking up the wood. Instead, I fantasize she made them cookies, cakes, or maybe pies. A Norman Rockwell grandma, with white hair pulled back in bun, stout, flour-dusted apron, all-forgiving smile. I don't bake cookies, cakes, or pies, but I do work, and I can give them money. These bra girls, although it's little that they ask, and so I give them more. It's towards a car, I grin, writing the check. The taller sister takes it, although she is still too young to drive. She's younger, but the leader. Goes to tech school, raises bulls. She wants to farm and work with oxen in the woods, just like her dad and uncle and their father, too. Her sister's older by a bit, but smaller and holds back. She's fond of chemistry and wants to go to college, be a teacher like their mom. It's all so wholesome. I'm in awe of it. These lives in pattern, just like those quilts up on their grandma's bed. We just keep on working, bend and lift and stack and build a pile. My sister, at her woodshed, down in the valley town, bemoans her lack of help. It's fertile river farmland there, once tended by large family clans of refugees from distant wars, whose long syllabic names are fading on the roadside stands. The kids don't want to work, my sister says. What's wrong with them? They're in the malls, paved over farmland that their fathers used to plant. Kids with bright screen devices blooming in their hands. The Hilltowns seem a world away from this, although they're not. Yet see these sturdy girls who josh and tease each other as they work. It pleases me that they are eased enough to chatter on as though I were not there. They started quiet, testing the tenor of the job and me, but good work loosens tongues, and as I work along, doing my share, their banter brightens. What he said to a friend, and how she called up after, what she said, he said, or did, and what they wore. I listen mostly to the flow, the girl wind blowing, but no, as these girls do not, how he will break her heart. How she'll recover, but will not forget him, that one. As I remember Johnny W., back when I was just 15, the scent of beer upon his breath, the mystery place where his tanned neck encountered that blue Oxford shirt, the taste of this first lust upon my body's mind, and I am pregnant with it now, forever. As some man, or woman maybe, will inhabit these strong girls, and they'll remember, each of them, just how it was. The salt of someone else's skin, the smell of it, the steamy radiance of touch. As they will not remember, 60 years from now, a woodpile day with that old woman who kept up with them, worked hard, bent, lifted, stacked, and built the pile, and watched and saw and wrote it down.